statement on screening and remote. You just need to pass them down. If you have questions, ask me questions. First of all, I would really like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak before you today. I'm really honored. It's been an amazing conference so far. And my topic is quantum reinforcement learning. This is advances in, but I suspect the topic is not so well known for me to be able to talk about big advances. It's what we know so far. And before I start talking about anything practical, I should really like to acknowledge a lot of collaborators that I've interacted with, of course, in the last 3 or 4 years. Predominantly the group of Hans Briegel in Innsbruck, unfortunately couldn't be here today because, you know, very inspiring talk on agents and learning in a quantum setting. The group of Justus Piatek, who is the chair of essentially the robotics division in Innsbruck, but also collaborators from Penset, from Vienna, and NIST and JQI. So not all of these people are co-authors on the talks that I'm specifically focusing on, but they definitely influence how I think about topics. So, I usually don't obsess about preparing talks, and I'm really not worried about the audience things. And I sort of just talk about whatever I like to talk about, and I prepare talks that make me laugh when I'm preparing them, and then maybe don't. But I found myself a little bit at a loss on how to begin. So one thing that this conference has shown me is that we really now exist as a community. We talk about quantum machine learning, or at least I do, in other conferences, right? But this is sort of our conference, and we are a community. But then if you just look at the titles of the talks and the contents, we do so diverse things that I don't know how many of you are capable of following everything, right? We're a bit of a mess. I don't mean this is an insult, this is a necessity. Because quantum information is sort of a field which is a bag of a bunch of things, and it got mixed with machine learning, which is probably worse. So this introduction is not really a deep thing. This is my preemptive apology, because I'm certain I will not be able to explain everything that I should. And I'm also certain that I'll be saying things that you all know very, very well. So please forgive me about that. In particular, this, of course, you know. We talk about quantum machine learning, which is a field which sort of combines machine learning and quantum information processing and studies sort of both directions of inference. We want to use quantum information processing to help machine learning tasks, and the other way around, use machine learning to apply to quantum information processing. But I would also like to argue that it also goes beyond, in a certain sense. It does more than just, you know, the sum of parts. So, this is the reason why I'm apologizing. I'm sure everybody knows this, right? You say quantum machine learning, so what is machine learning? And this is a tricky task. I would bet that if I asked every single one of you to write down what you think machine learning is in 5 sentences, I would get a large collection of very different sentences, right? But at least up until today, we have heard about these two things, with one exception, which was the first talk, which talked about semi-supervised and transactive learning. So for most intents and purposes in our community, machine learning is about unsupervised learning, which is about identifying the structure in the data, or more specifically, in the distribution which generates your data. Does anybody disagree with this definition? I'm really here to learn as well. Another thing is supervised learning, which is about inferring a conditional probability distribution of sort of labels given a data point, right? And it's a very, very possible. In fact, in recent times, machine learning has become very much a household term. You can find things like this which say that machine learning is going to, you know, revolutionize the job market, it's going to introduce the fourth industrial revolution, it's going to change our world in a very, very fundamental way. It might be true, in part it's certainly happening right now. There is a reason why this slide is here. I'm going to come back to it in a second. And this is the following, that I want to argue, I want to explain that there's more to machine learning than just data analysis. And so it was here, I don't know if anybody noticed, you pick up a paper which talks about amazing things that machine learning does, and then in between the lines you see the author's actually talking about aspects of computational intelligence. And this kind of switched. So some 5 to 10 years ago, whenever you had a large success in machine learning, the media called it a success in artificial intelligence. Now, machine learning is what we actually do, and everybody's happy. But there is stuff in machine learning which is not just about analyzing a set of data that you have, not just about inferring properties of some distributions, which is present in these pictures that I have here. So here, I'm sure you've seen this. This is a picture of a game with AlphaGo, a software played against, I think this is at least at all, where it was the first situation in which really the human grandmaster lost to a machine in the game. And this was a very, very important moment, because Go was this you know, this principal example of a hard game which computers will never be able to meet humans in, because it requires creativity. We have superhuman performance. Then here, so this is supposed to be Siri. So Siri actually, the way it comes now, uses supervised learning. So if you ever use an iPhone, switch it on, it asks you to tell it things a couple of times, it kind of learns to recognize your voice. By not coming words, it will actually learn for that later on. So it will ask you, it will require feedback from you, and then perform it correctly. You can make a mistake at some point. This interaction is a very important aspect of the type of learning I will be talking about, which is a reinforcement learning. And down the line, if you look up on what reinforcement learning is about, it will often say that it's the most demanding type of learning that AI types like. So if you want to build, you know, androids, at some point they have to be able to learn from interaction, learn from feedback, which is the type of learning. So reinforcement learning has a very simple basic paradigm. We talk about entities which are called agents, which exist relative to their environment. They perceive the environment, they receive percepts, they act on the environment by doing actions, and time and again, they receive rewards. Now, these rewards may be implicit, they might come from within agent, they might be provided by the environment, this depends on the setting, but this is more or less all there is. So one thing that I want to highlight at this point, we have an agent, we have an environment, and we have two alphabets. I'm pretending for the second that the interaction is always discrete in time, this is what we usually do. We have an alphabet of percepts and an alphabet of action, which are exchanged between the agent and the environment. It's more or less all there is. Now, this very, very simple framework actually captures a couple of very important examples. Number one, this is how most biological systems learn. So most biological systems don't do complicated analysis and data sets. We learn by trial and error. And we know that we made a mistake. So when you're a toddler, you run around, down the line you have some goal, when things fall apart, you know, you didn't get the reward, you get your freedom, right? For instance, so I genuinely don't think this is true, this is probably a lie, right here, but Roomba, you know, this automated vacuum cleaner, could in principle work by learning what your room looks like and then optimizing its trajectory later on over time as it finds out what your room looks like. In this case, it'd be, you know, moving around in this room, receiving the information about where it is, and then moving in different ways until it ends up. This example here, in this example, the agent is actually a very complex algorithm which is run maybe on a GPU, or a general purpose GPU, which is running some algorithm. In this case, playing Space Invaders. And this image here was taken from one of the early papers by the whole group on this reinforcement learning playing games, which was a paper which preceded the alpha. And one step beyond reinforcement learning, which is maybe an even more basic object, is simply the fact that we're talking about agents and environments, which is the so-called agent-environment paradigm. And since the late 90s, this is the language used when you talk about artificial intelligence in certain artificial intelligence. It's not everywhere. I will be talking about agents and environments. And it's a very generic thing. It's saying very little, but it's also capable of capturing a lot. In particular, it captures standard machine learning, in which case you have a database, and you have a computer program which is interacting with the database trying to find out something about it. This is naturally explained, expressed in this particular framework, where these things are very special types of actions and persons. And the environment is very special. We'll come back. Or, for instance, it can be a computer program playing a Go game against a human player. Or, it could be, for instance, a game in which an artificial agent, a program, is trying to convince a human evaluator that it is human. So now we have the setting of the two of this. So it's a quite a generic thing, this agent environment there. So, reinforcement learning has been getting recognition in recent times, again, predominantly because of this alpha process, the fact that humans are no longer the masters of the game. And here, so MIT Technology Review called it one of the 10 most influential technologies of the year, specifically reinforcement learning. Maybe I should clarify one thing. Somebody mentioned already AlphaGo at some point, they talked about deep learning being behind AlphaGo. This is in fact true. So I don't think that they would have been able to generate the AlphaGo software without utilizing the power of deep neural networks, which were applied to context of reinforcement. And maybe I should point out that even though the original game software which beats Elise et al. Did use a large database of games played by actual players in real life, the very recent result, which is called AlphaGo Zero, managed to achieve superhuman performance without any human supervision. So it was all done by self-play. So the computer played against itself, generated a large database of games. The only feedback it ever got was whether it lost or it won against itself. And in something 70-something with hours of gameplay, it became superhuman. This is quite insane from the perspective of what people have done in the Wolfram method. Right? So it played with itself and it won. And I want to argue that this reinforcement learning machinery is sort of, for me, it's a way of thinking about artificial intelligence. It's a path, right? So of course, you know, intelligent creatures do a lot of things. We recognize patterns, we speak, we recognize voice, we recognize written things. And I would believe that sort of the closest thing we're going to get to AI is probably inside we'll have a bunch of components, right? It's going to have solutions to knowledge representation problems. It's going to have optical character recognition and vision and reasoning and inference, and I'm hoping Peter will be talking about these things tomorrow. Things we call also good old-fashioned AI, which is about symbol manipulation. But it's also going to have reinforcement, right? So part of me is thinking all the time about how one day we're going to be talking about quantum AI for real, not just as a vision. So going back to reinforcement learning and the basic paradigm, I will have to tell you a couple of terms I will be using throughout the talk, which you might or might not have heard about. So one thing I will be talking about agents, which run some learning model. Right? I have percepts, I have actions, I have rewards, which are functions of percepts, actions, and maybe even the history of percepts, actions, and I have environments. Now, environments come in many flavors. So for me, environment is what the word means in English. It's everything that's not known. Right? Now, in mathematical circles, in sort of computer science and mathematical circles, there are types of environments which are easy to represent. One type of such environment is any environment which is describable by a Markov decision process. The Markov decision process is an environment which has a bunch of states. Each action of the agent causes a transition from some state to another, and the agent perceives the state that the environment is in subsequent state. Certain transitions can be reformed. Okay? So note, the environment, NDP isn't an environment, it's a description of the environment. And a simple one, because the agent gets to see everything there is to know about the environment. What do agents learn? What do we care about? Well, at any given point, something here inside, in the learning agent, has to define what the agent will do given a state, given a person, right? So this thing we usually call a policy. So policy is a conditional probability distribution which gives you an action given a state. It just defines what the agent does in a given state. Now, if we agree that certain transitions in a specific environment are rewarding, I can write things like this. I can write sort of the expected reward that the agent gets if it behaves according to certain policy. And now we're starting to think about what kinds of possible figures of merit, so the properties that we want to optimize, I need to demand it to do. So for instance, I would care about, I want an agent which will over time maximize the rewards in subsequent n steps. If it picks the number n, these things are usually called finite horizon rewards. Or I might care about long-term performance, maybe in some sense forever. Now note, if the environment is finite and one age is rewarding, a random action will over time accumulate a divergent amount of rewards, right? Simply add up non-zero numbers, it will diverge. So to suppress this, you take something which is called discount factor, appreciation factor. So this gamma here is a number between 0 and 1, strictly smaller than 1, which means this series converge. So if you care about optimizing this parameter, which is also a function of the parameter gamma, then you talk about infinite horizon reinforcement. So your basic textbook reinforcement learning usually deals with environments which are representable by Markov decision process, and which often is one of these two things, most often this. And in fact, we understand quite a lot about how to do reinforcement learning when we want to optimize this stuff. Two more things that I want to point out that I will need in a second is the notion of the history of interactions. For me, this is the most important part. So what's inside the environment, I don't necessarily get to see. Right? I see parts of it, not all of it. There is some state, but what I see is what the environment presents. It's the things which are sort of collected in persons. There are things that I do, which are the actions, and there are some signature rewards, which I get to see. And everything that I can potentially want to say about quality of learning better be a function of these things and nothing else. I don't want to be looking into the brain of the agent or the brain of the environment to be able to see whether something is a learning process or not. Hence, the history of interaction is sort of a key process that they will want to maintain when I talk about quantum animals, these particular objects. So now we're maybe just one more thing that I need to tell you is that you cannot have an optimal learning model in general. So there's something called no for lunch theorems. Many of you know these things in the context of optimization or supervised learning. It also exists in the context of reinforcement learning. It's essentially a Hume's principle of induction, you know, formalized. It says that you cannot have an optimal learning agent. It has to be specific to the environment. Otherwise, no two agents actually behave better than another if you randomize over all those environments. Which also tells you that it makes sense to parameterize learning models. So they're going to have certain parameters. These parameters, which you can choose depending on what you know about the environment, these things are called metaparameters. They're analogs and hyperparameters in supervised learning. Okay. And now one slide of distinction between reinforcement learning and machine learning, as we've seen in this talk so far. But I would like to emphasize, not just in talk so far, if you take a random text from machine learning, 60% of the time it will not talk about reinforcement learning. 40% of the time it will. If you go on Wikipedia, look at machine learning, it will be mentioned as the third canonical category of reinforcement of machine learning. Up to you, if it's separate or not. But there is one fundamental distinction. So this data-driven machine learning, it's an agent environment framework where the data is fixed order. I don't get to change it. I get to query the final parts of it, but I don't change it. In reinforcement learning, the agent changes the state of the environment. So this is sort of the fundamental defining difference between the two models. You don't get to change the distribution. I should maybe point out that, of course, there are intermediary models. There's models like online learning, which is like a supervised learning, but you don't get your data set in advance. You don't get it in time. Then you have active learning, active supervised learning, actually more exactly what the agent is to probe the environment for examples that he wants to know more about, to perform better, and so on, but this is maybe not true. Quantum reinforcement learning. So I want to write what is quantum reinforcement learning. Maybe in the box here I would like to say what we would like quantum reinforcement learning to be, right? This is an example of what it would mean. Well, unsurprisingly, essentially do everything that we do in other branches of quantum machine learning, right? We can think about using reinforcement learning in quantum information processing or quantum experiments, and there's an increasing number of interesting papers in this context. So I should point out that, of course, aspects of reinforcement learning are present whenever you're close to industry, right? When people want results and they're not doing research, they use reinforcement learning and machine learning, all of it. It's just that we're trying to be more systematic now from the scientific point of view. So there's no way you can read these things here. Apologies, but this is a bunch of references to people that apply reinforcement learning experiments. And a part of the story is really about solving particular problems, but there are people who are hypothesizing, trying to understand what are the potential limits, how much can we actually exploit machines in doing research itself, which is an interesting problem, right? So, you know, you can sort of intuitively understand how machines or robots are useful in labs, like they pull down your ion traps automatically, they keep track, they get rid of noise, things like this. But maybe they can do more. Maybe they can actually help in proposing new quantum experiments. So this is one of the things that we've done with a model of projective simulation, which you would have heard about if Hans was here, not me. But I will skip that. I will talk about something else. Another topic is quantum enhanced machine learning, and this should be reinforcement learning, which is, as you can imagine, I want to use quantum computers to do reinforcement learning better, whatever that means. And already now we can talk about various flavors to this. Just like in the standard data-driven machine learning case, we can talk about quantum enhancements for specific algorithms. So there's a group, one qubit, which focuses on one type of a machine learning algorithm, which uses a deep Boltzmann machine inside. In fact, it's an unrestricted one, and then you use quantum text to train it better. We've done a paper where we speed up internal processing of a model called projective simulation by using quantum random walks. Then we can do another type of thing, which is quantum enhancements, where we allow a quantum interaction between the agent and the environment. So this is sort of, you can call it a more fundamental question, you can call it a more unfeasible question, or a question which is maybe less important in practice, but I like it, and I think it's very interesting. In fact, this is what we'll be talking about today. So if you give me everything, what is it that I could hope for if I had access to fully blown quantum computers? And finally, one can also think about quantum generalizations of reinforcement learning. Just to clarify, quantum information, you're not surprised when somebody talks about quantum data, everyone sort of has a feeling what that's supposed to mean. Right? So the same way I take classical data and I generalize it and I call it quantum data where I bring in a quantum state, you could try to do the entire thing with all the objects which appear in the theory of reinforcement learning. So some people have thought about this. For instance, Scott Aronson has a paper on quantum generalizations of partial observable market chains, market decision processes. Again, not something I will be talking about. So my topic is really quantum enhancements in the context of quantum cosmology. So the entire story actually started without us focusing on reinforcement learning. We talked about agents, we talked about environments, we talked about artificial intelligence, we talked about models for artificial intelligence, and we're aware that there are things which are called agents and environments, and they communicate with chain of actions. What we wanted to say is we want to formulate, to be precise, and to make meaningful statements which begin with what happens if the agent is a classical thing, or what happens if the agent is a quantum thing, the same thing for the environment. So we just wanted to make sense out of that. We have some intuition, but we want to make it very, very rigorous. And we did that, so this was sort of the first step of what happened to reinforcement learning. But for this, we made certain choices. And the choices basically boil down on what we understand under the word environment. I think I hinted towards this. For me, the environment is the real thing. It's a thing outside. So in computer science circles, the environment is an MVP, or is a PMVP, or is a Turing machine. These are abstractions. In robotics, environments are very, very real objects. So this is a figure, I think, from 2011. This is a Google car. Right? So this is what the car sees. This is its environment, right? So from the perspective of quantum information processing, the easiest thing for me to think about was that environment is some sort of a system. It's a black box, which is down the line fully characterized by the entire set, the entire collection of input-output relations I can plug in. So no, it's not a unitary map. It's a thing which has internal memory, internal structure. So you can imagine having this box, having the button which resets it, whatever that means, and simply trying to input all the possible actions I could, receiving all the possible percepts and assigning the probability to each one of these units. If I have the collection of all these infinite sequences, I have a full characterization of this box. So this is what an environment is. It's a black box, nothing more. And if I do that, I'm kind of unable to be precise. It's very messy to describe the entire object by the set of all possible sequences that I can plug in and get from the box. So I'm going to fix things, and I'm going to say, well, an environment, wherever it is, it's a collection of completely positive and trace-preserving maps, which are the things that quantum mechanics allows, which has its internal memory, and which act on the memory and a communication channel, which connects me, or rather the agent, to the environment. So to clarify, you had the picture with the agent and the environment. Well, the agent only sees things which are here. It doesn't get to see inside the environment. This is captured by the fact that there's one special register, which is really connecting the environment to the agent. It allows me to talk about these two things separately and the thing that they both see. And this is very standard in this point of communication. This thing will be called a channel. Okay, so this is the thing that two players get to see. They don't get to see the inside. So the environment, whatever it is certainly describable by an infinite sequence of completely positive trace-preserving maps acting on the channel in itself, and the same thing holds for the agent. And I wasn't very creative here in that, this describes everything that I can possibly have in a turn-based agent, right? But this is what I actually have. Agents are sequences. These things are sometimes called quantum cones. Even though quantum cones technically are finite, these things I would like to be to make infinite. Now, once I've done this, I can actually talk about the classical limits. So, I don't mean limits in the sense of setting some parameter to zero or h bar to one or c to one. What I mean is if I choose these maps to be such that they don't generate entanglement, that they don't generate superpositions, then it behaves like a classical system. So, it certainly captures everything classical systems do. And you can ask me, this is a very fair question, why? Why go there? Why do anything like that? Well, one of the reasons is sort of very fundamental. We want to understand what it means to learn in the quantum world. Where by learning, I really mean that one system learns about another system. And the other thing is because maybe I could do things faster. Right? And because this is who gets your grants and publishes papers, so we're going to focus on that part of the story. And it turns out that there are at least two things that, in broad strokes, I can think about when I want to improve things. One thing is computational complexity and the learning efficiency. I briefly mentioned these things. So computational complexity is simply, how long does it take to run the algorithm of the agent, the internal algorithm, at every time step? So in particular, this is the one cubic model where they have to, you know, optimize an unrestricted Boltzmann machine. This has a very high computational complexity. Maybe it's worthwhile, maybe it's not. The learning efficiency is something which I can read out from the interactions. It doesn't care about what's happening inside the reaction. So this, don't take this plot seriously. So this is something we call an efficiency curve, which imagines a scenario where the agent is facing an environment which can give it a reward of unit value. And this thing plots a fictitious probability of the agent getting a reward at any given time step. And you see these curves go up because the agent is learning. So when we see things in experiments like this, we say the agent is learning, and somehow the blue agent seems to be learning better than the red agent. Now there's a bunch of theory which tells you how to build models which make these curves go to one, if you know a little bit about the environment, like the observable. But here I would really like to think about whether I can use quantum mechanics to make these curves go up faster, or under which conditions I can do that. So this is speed up in learning efficiency. So for the people who are very much at home in quantum information, this is essentially a sample complexity. Right? I'm trying to learn about the focus of the environment, I'm trying to do it faster using quantum mechanics. So one of the things that we figured out very early on, and it's sort of a trivial thing, that if you have a quantum agent and you have an environment, if there's a classical filter between the two, so if there's a real world even further around, which sort of couples to our communication channel and dephases all the time, then I certainly cannot expect for there to be a quantum method which is somehow fundamentally better than any classical one. Simply because if the input-output relations are purely classical, whatever is happening in my quantum agent, I can actually simulate classically with exponential slowdown. Note, if I'm only focusing on learning efficiency, I don't care about computational complexity. And I want to decouple these two things. I really want to think about things that happen in between, not worrying about what's happening on the side. But under these conditions, and it's very easy to prove by a simulation argument that whatever model I come up with, which is quantum, I can do the same thing class. So I know I cannot have any improvements which are not direct consequences of computational improvements. My intuition is, you know, you cannot run Grover search on a classical formula, right? You need to put it in a quantum database or something like that. However, if I allow this thing to not be classical, then I can do more. This should not come as a surprise. It also should not come as a surprise that I cannot do more always. In particular, I've so far defined environments as a sequence of CPTV maps. This also means that this includes maps which measure the state of the register of the communication channel and throws the information away. If it does that, even though I'm unaware of it, I'm actually in this set. So I have to be careful about how I define my maps, which might allow improvements. And this is actually a tricky business. And here's where I really have to put a disclaimer and say, I will demand a lot to be able to show that there's something you can do. And then I will leave for posterity to tell me how much I've overshot and that we can actually achieve something with fewer requirements. So I will be considering a scenario where I have a classical agent and a classical environment and I'm somehow quantizing the entire picture such to get the advantage. And the intuition comes from oracular computation theory, right? So I mentioned this before, environment for me is something that is fully unclear. I don't know anything about it. I know how to put things inside, something comes up. This is very much like a regular computation. So there's some processing block, there's some query to an unknown oracle, then I get feedback back, and I'm doing it again, and something comes out in the end. So this is your picture. So this thing, this part here, the processing block is sort of agent-like, and the environment is oracle-like. Of course, unfortunately, these things will not look like this. It's going to be a lot more complex than that. So for now, I would like to think of environments as oracles. Is anybody here very unfamiliar with quantum oracular computation? Who has not heard of the Deutsch-Euler algorithm or Grover search? And don't be shy, it's okay. So you define quantum maps by a classical process, and these quantum maps allow querying and superposition, so plugging in states which are in this very weird quantum system, and by using this you can infer certain information about the box faster. So this is the basic result of Grover search. Certain databases are quantum, so the way you can actually query them with quantum maps. Now, how will I use this? What's sort of the key idea? So one of the fundamental problems in oracular computation is the problem of oracle identification. So I tell you that my box that I have, that I'm querying, is one from some collection of boxes, which is well defined, and my task is to identify which one. Now, depending on how I choose my task, sometimes I can do a exponentially better than any classical system or polynomial or something they cannot do at all. And I will do a similar thing for environments, because Ripoll had mentioned that learning loops have metaparameters. Right? So if you tell me, the more I know about the environment, the better I can build the learning agent which is going to thrive in the given environment. And this is sort of a fundamental thing, this is a necessity. So my basic picture is, I know that my environment comes from some large set. If I knew which one it was, I could build the optimal engine immediately, but I don't. So suppose that this large environment is actually, you know, either in the group A1, A2, A3, AN, so these are just subgroups of the possible environments, and suppose that my learning agent has parameters which makes it best suited for the type A1, A2, A3, and so on. So one thing that I could hope for is to use quantum computing or quantum access, as if I'm doing a regular identification, to pinpoint which environment I'm in, then I optimize my learning agent, and then I just step back and just let it interact classically. So this is the basic idea, which we sort of worked out for three classes of examples. One important thing is that this identification process and the optimization tool here has to somehow be more worthwhile than using just the classical agent to find out which environment is in and meet the rewards. Right? So I have to have a way. But I mentioned before that environments are not oral. So in particular, they're not unitary maps, they have memory, they're uncontrollable, or they're wild. So we will have to do a trick which we call oracularization, which has two parts, one which is very legit. So I will somehow use multiple interactions with the unknown environment to generate, to simulate an oracle which hides some useful information about the environment. That will become very specific and second, so it's going to be so abstract. But I just want to say the one part of the story is that I'm going to use a bunch of interactions to simulate one Hopman oracle, so it's going to be blocked like this. So this thing we call blocking. So one way of thinking about this is simply, you know, you take your quantum comb, which is nothing but thinking of these maps as one large object where you plug in the agent here, so it has, you know, this input output. I can rewrite it as a quantum layer. So now it looks like something which takes the input from the left and produces an output on the right, which essentially means that the agent commits to a set of actions, no matter what the environment does, it just plays out the sequence of actions and collects the sequence of persons, right? It just walking. So this is called walking. Unfortunately, this is still not enough to get something which behaves like an oracle, because, you know, the actions of the agent produced are not given back to the agent. I will give you an example about this. So this is somehow I have to circumvent. So I have to steal information from the environment. I have to actually we use the word scavenging. Now we're using the word recycling, because scavenging sounds like something one shouldn't be doing. I'm looking at you, because you were scavenging many years ago. We're partially inspired by that stuff. So they did the work where they do quantum measurement, get some information about the system, but then you can still get some information out of it, only if I remember correctly. Right, so what's oracularization about? Where's this part that we're cheating the environment? I'll give you an analogy instead of being false. So I mentioned a second ago that we have this quantum function, regular quantum computation, where you have some unitary which is sort of hiding a classical function. So typically what you have a function which is defined in bit strings, and it outputs one bit in a bit string. You take out Nielsen inch one, the first page, and you're going to see things like this. So this is my bit string, this is an ancilla, I plug into my unitary, I get my bit string back, and I get a bit flip condition on the value of the function which is actually encoded in my oracle. And they say, well, this is the quantum analog, right? Because quantum mechanics is unitary. Quantum mechanics is unitary in a closed system, not an environment. This is actually what quantum mechanics would look like. I put in a quantum state, which is now a density matrix, a projector onto my bit string. What comes out is a projector on the output. This is the analog. And this is completely useless for quantum mechanics. There's nothing you can do with this. So our process of regularization is simply saying, I will not be always specific how, but somehow instead of this, I managed to get this. I will give you examples of when this can be done. For instance, if you're doing a quantum experiment, it makes sense because the information is never lost, it's there, and you actually know where it's localized, you can access it without cheating in a reinforcement learning problem. More importantly, you can use it in a simulation, but maybe I'll talk about this a little bit more. Bottom line, what we get is something like this. So instead of a scenario in which we already did the blocking, which is just a conceptual thing, I commit to a sequence of actions and then I put the first episode in one block, I get something like this. So I'm capable of stealing the information from the environment, somehow uncomputing what the environment did, to get something which depends just on my actions, and does something to Mozilla in a manner which depends on the reward. This is an example of virtualization. In particular, this particular bit is going to be one relevant bit which gives me an edge over a fully classable agent. So for virtualization, two steps. One is the blocking part, and the second part of the story is this part where I somehow get the purification of my system, if you wish, right? Which is otherwise completely costing the system. So in data-driven machine learning, in fact, I don't have a problem, right? Because my quantum database is a unitary map. So it's weird to think about a database as a process, but this is what it is, right? You plug in an address, what comes out is an address and the state of that address, and when you do that, you move to position and so on, which effectively means that it has no memory in my language. This is weird. The database doesn't have memory. It's just a unitary map, acting on nothing but the communication. Right? There's nothing to purify. It's a relatively simple scenario to describe essentially all algorithms which deal with quantum computers. Here I have to get rid of the fact that this depends on the environment, and I can only do that if the environment allows me. So these are the restrictions. So the overall result has a relatively generic scheme. So this is a plot from one of the papers that we had, which sort of compares what a classical agent does versus what a quantum enhanced agent does. So the quantum enhanced agent will first use this or actualization processes to get some information about the classical environment using quantum access. Then, in the intermediary stage, and this costs no interaction steps, this will not be visible in the interaction history, it optimizes internally its model to make it the best possible model for that particular classical environment we've identified, and from that point on, it just steps away. I mean, the quantum part steps away, it just plays out by classical interaction. So this looks like maybe we could have done something more. But in practice, I mean, you know, applied reinforcement learning into the classical environments. I want it to be classical. Yeah. It doesn't make sense to me to go from all the way. So one of the first results we had is what you could call a quantum algorithm. So it was a result we said something along the lines of, give me any learning model in an environment which together makes sense, which is more or less means that this model will learn in this environment. I can make a quantum agent out of it, which learns faster. Of course, the counter holds as well. If it sucks in this environment, it will suck worse when I quantize it, but this is irrelevant. So it says that if you give me an environment which I can actually quantize in a beneficial way, and you give me a learning model which does well, I can make it perform better. And it is really, really here. We use Grover like amplification essentially to learn examples of behavior which lead to rewards. I will clarify this in a second. But I want to give you the second example, which is closer to the intuition I gave you before, which is identify the subset of environments you're in and then optimize the internal meta parameters of the model. This is quantum speed of a meta learning. So I mentioned that learning models almost always have meta parameters. Like when we say neural networks, the configuration of the neural network is a meta parameter. Like you can choose different configurations. But certain learning models, specifically if it's Q-learning, we work with projective simulation, they usually have real parameters that you get to tune. One of the parameters is called an alpha parameter, or another one is called eta, it doesn't matter what they do, but they're one-dimensional things which you have to tune depending on the environment you're in. So if you search over the setting of the parameters. And when you can actually quantize the entire setting, the environment and the agent, I can, since you're here, what I can do, I can oracleize a large block in such a way that I get an oracle which takes in the specification of the metaparameters and actually feeds me back information about how well the agent would have performed under that set of metaparameters. Now, if I have such an oracle, I can actually do more or less standard and old-fashioned quantum optimization techniques together with, for instance, a quadratic speedup in finding optimal parameters. Now, if you know that your optimal parameters, you know, the performance is a function of optimal parameters that you give a model or something like this, then of course, you know, you're going to do more efficient techniques. But if your environment is complex enough, it makes sense. Sometimes there's nothing to do but a blind brute force search, in which case you can get a direct intuition. Now we did this because it's sort of just the formalization of intuition. I'm not personally in love with this particular result because, in fact, we have to oracleize a large block of interaction, like millions upon millions of steps. In contrast, the first result that I pointed out as a paper, the upgrade paper, I need to quantize much less. I need to quantize up until the first step of the result. So getting the first word instance. I don't need to get statistics on performance. So this is sort of somehow more feasible. Not that I'm saying that any of this is actually feasible in practice. Now, there's a piece of quantum purport that says that you can grow as if. So, in quantum mechanics, more or less, you can always get a cogenic speed up, and moreover, it was believed up until very, maybe a few years ago. In fact, you always get a quadratic speed up. In 2015, we had the cheat sheet technique which showed a 2.5 improvement, and I think there are other results. But it's also kind of understood that you don't get super polynomial speed ups. This was, I think, one of the first results in 1993, attention in Vasirami showed. For instance, you cannot brute force grower. You cannot search in better than quadratic speed up. So you need special structure in your problem to be able to get the super polynomial speed up. So one question we ask is, does reinforcement learning in any sense generically give in any instance structure which allows super polynomial speed ups? This sounded like a very, very clever question, and then it turned out it was a very, very stupid question. Because reinforcement learning, a special case, contains essentially everything. Factoring, I can rephrase the reinforcement learning. Computational learning theory, like learning Boolean function and so on, I can express the reinforcement learning. Pattern recognition, I can express the reinforcement learning. So if you give me any situation in which there is a quantum speedup, which is exponential, I can rephrase it as a reinforcement learning situation where you get a quantum speedup for free. So in that sense, the reinforcement learning is too big, and it's a trivial question whether we can get exponential speedups. However, then we can demand, so I'm having a back and forth with my collaborators on this, what it means for something to be a genuine reinforcement learning problem. I want to talk about natural problems for reinforcement learning. And I'm afraid I do not know enough about reinforcement learning, in particular not enough about reinforcement learning in practice, to be able to say, aha, this is the set of criteria I want. But for instance, what I can do is demand criteria which sort of eliminate certain things, like it is not a computational problem, so it's not a decision problem, it's not a computational learning problem. So I insist on such criteria, and whatever remains has to be a structure which at least contains whatever generic reinforcement learning problems. So this is what we did relatively recently. We stipulated a bunch of criteria we want on the task environment, the environment, called generic. Which does two things at the same time. One, maintains it hard to learn for any classical agent, whereas allows to actually oracularize in a way which allows us to supercomputer. So, this is what it looks like. So recall, at some point I mentioned early on that some environments are describable with Markov decision processes. So Markov decision processes have states, right? And they have actions which cause transitions. So here's a state space of the environment that we concocted. The environment is huge. It's more or less a tree which, with a bunch of self loops and one distinguished branch where only a given sequence of actions gives a reward. Right? So whatever the agent does here, in the end, it has to somehow learn to do this one sequence of moves where only one sequence of moves leads to the reward. However, there is a bit of stochasticity in it, which we sort of manually plugged into. We had one of the criteria, which is that there is stochasticity in it to make it sort of a genuine. When you do oracularization over this, by a magical, and this is a completely accidental thing, we end up with an oracle which is actually encoding the recursive reassembling problem, which is one of the first four problems which show better than polynomial separation from classical polynomials. For some time, we reverse engineered it. Right? We started with the recursive reassembling problem and found an entity which encodes this particular problem, and then shuffled it around. And then in fact, later on it became apparent that we worked very, very hard for something which is quite simple, and you can encode Simon's problem, which is kind of interesting. So for recursive Fourier sampling, we know that it allows a super polynomial, some people call it quasi-polynomial separation between classical and quantum algorithms, but we also know that you cannot raise it to a true exponential separation, whereas Simon's problem does have a true exponential separation. So the strongest separation that we have is really for the Simon's problem, which maintains this generic properties in the environment. So, when talking about generic properties, let me just tell you. So one thing is delayed rewards. So it has to be such that the agent doesn't immediately know whether it's on the right path. Its actions have to really genuinely influence the state of the environment, so it can do the wrong thing. And it has to have not too much degeneracy in the optimal qualities. It means that it has to learn a lot about the potential percept action theory to be able to perform optimally. If you don't have that, you have things which very much look like standard computational learning theory. Maybe this is too much. Right. So I'm almost out of time. So I just want to contrast the first thing we did, which is this quantum operator versus this absolute separation. I think So in this first paper, we really started with environments which we see in reinforcement learning, which are maze-like environments. We figured out, well, maze is deterministic. That means that, in fact, I don't need to see percepts. I just need to learn my sequence of actions, which leads me to the exit to win. And this I can go price. So maybe I win in some environments. In this work here, we actually went the other way around. We knew which oracle we want to attain, so we reverse engineered environments and then figured out that we can actually make them a little bit more generic looking. We can make them larger, we can make them low degree, we can make them quite stochastic, and still, by the oracleization process, you end up with the right oracle, and you can separately prove that it's still hard for classical agents to learn in those environments. So I will just end with a few perspectives on this type of quantum reinforcement learning. So, one of the things is, of course, when I allow this quantum interaction between the agent and the environment, so the learning system the entire time, I can think about quantum AI and quantum Turing test. Specifically, the Turing test doesn't care about what's inside the agent, it just cares about its performance, and we have a framework for thinking about this. People who deal with cognitive architectures who insist that intelligence requires a particular type of structure of the brain of the device, they would simply disagree with our approach, and I don't know what the truth is. Then, so far, we've connected quantum reinforcement learning to regular quantum computation, but we could think about other things. For instance, the phone test rule, Elixir and Weidman, is a way of sort of preventing the agent from doing wrong things. If you don't know what it is, it doesn't really matter. It's connected to computational computation. But we can connect it to quantum metrology, we can connect it to things like quantum illumination, which might be the most interesting thing because it allows a lot of phasing, to gain advantage. So it can be messier than what we've done. Then, so far, things are quite generic. We can connect it to quantum machine learning because, unsurprisingly, reinforcement learning uses machine learning as something. One of the most exciting things that might come out of this is actually sort of a spin-off. So you see, we can think of this environments and the maps that we have as a generalization of standard oracles. Right? Since there is a reduction from these maps to standard oracles, this is a valid generalization, so we can think about having new results. Unfortunately, I cannot claim that we have any, but there's a possibility that this is happening. And then, of course, there are very pragmatic questions like, okay, so what are the minimal things that we need to do? What's the minimum amount of intrusion we need to do the environment to get advantages? I can think about 10 things which are really quantum systems. So this is a very exciting thing. So really having a quantum system which uses quantized reinforcement learning to improve itself. And I think we've heard ideas like this of really embedding it in one quantum system and getting advantage out before forget to mention that. And finally, so this is a question that anybody cares, how all these things which are, of course, requiring full quantum interaction and quantum access to environments, how do they actually map to actual improvements and actual real-world reinforcement learning applications? My answer is, it's very indirect. So, of course, I cannot demand quantum interaction with a classical environment. But what I can do model-based learning. I can have an agent which, in the process of this learning, learns certain parameters of its environment, and then uses internal processing to use the model of the environment to optimize its actions. It's a standard technique. And since it's happening within the agent, I no longer need quantum interaction. I do not get the advantage in terms of interaction steps, because everything comes from classical interaction, but I do get improvement in classical processes. And recall, this is the most I can hope for because of, you know, when there's classical filter, I cannot get anything there. Right. Also, this could lead to something called quantum behavioral databases, where you kind of pre-train an agent for an environment. So you simulate an agent to the conditions of the moon Titan, and then you send it off to Titan rather than having it learn at the face of the place in the street. And I will end with this. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Any questions for Heather?
Can you say something more about this oracularization, especially the second one, this E sub F? How do you implement this?
How do I implement this?
Yeah, so from what you've written, I'm not sure if I take it literally, because it seems to take pure states to pure states, right? Or is there some...
Yeah, but I mean, this picture here, you get this map, if you take this map, you trace out this register.
Sorry? If you take...
This map here, you actually get from this map, if you trace out this register. So the environment keeps my input.
you won't, well, you should get a sum then, right? Sum of all x, which take you to the same f of x. What I'm trying to say, I guess, is that f need not be reversible. It can take many bit strings, no single bit.
No, but imagine I just trace out the straight string. You will get exactly one state here, right?
If you have...
Because this is one-to-one. This is one-to-one. So when you trace out, there's still remain in a few states. Right, so in the regularization process of the agent, what I actually need to know is which part of the agent's memory contains my actions that I gave away, which the environment can throw away once it finishes an episode. And then instead of throwing it away, which the environment had to trace out left and back memory, I take it back. So I'm invading the part of the memory which has nothing to do with the environmental program, if I want to implement.
In the end, you mentioned ways for reinforcement learning implementing machine learning capabilities.
Yes.
Were you referring to classical reinforcement learning, or do you, to prove your speed ups, do you actually use quantum machine learning algorithms typically?
No. So in our work, we don't. But just to give an example, the one qubit people who are looking at is using this deep. Unrestricted Boltz machines for reinforcement learning. I mean, what they have is a specification of a classical model, which you could speed up if you had, you know, quantum devices, potentially. Right? And we know that there are examples of quantum algorithms which actually have an exponential separation. So if I'm just a little bit more general in what I want from my reinforcement learning model, which is maybe generalization performance, which you don't necessarily think about in reinforcement learning, then you can, you know, expand a lot the collection of algorithms which are immediately useful. We have done this. Just saying. It might not even be smart, but it can be done.
And the last one there before the next speaker.
Could you please elaborate a little bit more about the Weidman and Weidman-Baum tester aspect and the counterfactual computation?
Are you familiar with the proposal, with the thought experiment?
Yes.
So I can do exactly the same thing. So imagine I'm doing reinforcement learning, but I'm dealing with negative rewards. This we call positive punishment in the context of open conditioning. It means that if I do the wrong thing, I get a negative signal. Right? So think of negative signal as a bomb exploding. It's a very negative signal. So what I want to say is that the bomb tester itself is a reinforcement learning scenario with a very, very clear positive punishment. Right? You know you did something wrong. And yet it solves it, right? You find out something about the bomb in the case, in one of the cases, right? In the cases. So if you generalize on this, you get something which looks like reinforcement learning, where the agent simply never makes a mistake. In the sense of, if you have the transcripts of history, this agent never messed up. Which is actually non-trivial, because one of the canonical problems in reinforcement learning is so-called ridge walking, where the agent walks a ridge and can fall down, one on the other side. So this is a canonical example.
But if we look that way, all quantum mechanics is a sort of reinforcement learning experience, because back action is generic. All quantum measurements are, there is always a back action from the system to the measuring apparatus. So it's always a sort of learning experience for the measurement device.
I think I agree, but I agree more if you could make it more precise.
Maybe we can continue the discussion at the coffee break.
Thank you.